Scientists call them Leucochloridium paradoxum. Lay people call them green-banded broodsacs. But we call them parasitic disco zombie worms. Not because we have to, but because we can. These worms are as trippy as a light-up dance floor, complete with strobes. And they'll make any snail they enter panic at the disco. Hi, I'm Danielle Dufault, and you're watching Animalogic. In today's adventure into the world's freakiest parasites, we're learning all about the flatworm that encourages birds to peck its host's eyes out. Nope, this isn't a Hitchcock villain. This is a green-banded brood sac. Ha! The circle of life. What a wonderful thing. Except for maybe when that circle is a complete horror spiral that involves mind-controlling parasites, unwilling zombies with eyes that are on a three-day bender, live worms laying eggs inside of birds' butts, and culminating in our rancid egg-riddled poop feast. That is how the green-banded brood sac survives generation to generation, more or less. It begins, and I suppose also ends, with a steaming pile of bird poop. Green-banded brood sacs find their way into their unwitting hosts by stowing away in the poop of passerines, which are sometimes referred to as perching birds or songbirds. This enormous order of birds, with over 6,500 species on every continent except for Antarctica, comprises about 60% of all birds. Because of the great number of hosts, the green-banded broodsac can be found in Europe, North America, and Japan. And recently, there have been some unconfirmed reports from South America. Appealing to such a wide target audience is definitely smart marketing on the part of the green-banded broodsac. It ensures it'll be gobbled up quickly after its severely diabolical scheme is finally in place. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's start at the beginning with the egg-riddled poop. Along comes a member of the Succinaidae family, the favorite snail that the green-banded broodsac targets. These snails are colloquially called amber snails because of their amber-colored shells, which are thin and translucent. This translucent quality is going to be important later. While gross for us, bird poop is actually a highly nutritious meal, at least for a snail. Bird droppings are full of nitrogen, phosphorus, and other essential nutrients. But before anyone starts a new diet fad, I have to express very clearly that bird turds are chock full of bacteria, fungi, and parasites, so they should never be consumed by humans. But I guess the snails didn't get the memo about the parasites in the bird poop because they gobble it up like candy, green-banded broodsac eggs and all. Once inside the snail, the green-banded broodsac sets into motion the first phase of its plan. You've heard of a full-body makeover. This is a full-body takeover. Straight out of a horror movie, once inside the snail, the eggs hatch and turn into long, hairy larvae called neurocidia, which begin wandering through the snail's body. Thankfully for the snail, these little immature freaks don't have mouths, so like a lot of parasitic worms, they just soak up the snail's nutrients through their skin. Did you know that human tapeworms don't have mouths either? If you picture a tapeworm chowing down on the chow you just downed, you're incorrect. They absorb nutrients the same way disco worm larvae do, right through their outer tissue. The more you know.
Questions like that really keep feeding our interest in nature and science. We all love to learn more about the world around us, which is why I'm super excited to open this Curiosity Box. Curiosity Box is a subscription service that sends you awesome science-themed toys and t-shirts.
Oh, nice.
As well as books, experiments, and collectibles. It's a subscription box for thinkers.
Cool. Every box is unique and full of amazing items you can't find anywhere else. Let's see what I got. These are two optical illusions in one t-shirt. The bezeled effect makes it look like the letters are different colors, but they aren't. And the Stroop effect makes your brain work extra hard to name those colors. It's confusing in the most delightful way possible. There's also this helix-shaped jigsaw puzzle, which tells you the history of life on planet Earth. And let's build this in 1 second. Ooh. And check out these slide rule chopsticks. They come with an inbuilt mechanical calculator. They'll make figuring out the tip easier than ever. A Puzzle Me Twice book, an exclusive book with 70 puzzles most people usually get wrong. And of course, a prism. Isaac Newton's favorite rainbow maker. No, really, we owe so much of what we know about light to this little tool. These are all awesome, and I'm already excited to get my next box. And if you love science, I hope you get yours too. Scan this QR code or click the link in the description and use promo code ANIMA30 for a 30% off discount on your first month of your subscription. And use code BODYDECK to get this awesome deck of cards that gives you a series of cross sections in the human body. It's super fun to shuffle. And even more fun stuff? If you get a yearly subscription, you get these Denary dice. You know how regular dice have 6 faces? Well, this set has dice with an increasing number of faces, from 1 to 10. I know I'll use them for role-playing games. So scan the QR code and use the promo code to connect with science and spark your curiosity. Okay, let's go back to those brooding sacs. Once they've sent out tentacles to locate the eye stalks, they are ready to continue their ultimate plan, going back to where they came from, the digestive tract of a bird.
To do this, the miracidia turns into the famous brood sac, which is basically a living bag full of baby worm clones. Creepy. At this point, the brood sac gets its psychedelic disco pulsating colors. The idea is to be as conspicuous as possible to get the attention of a hungry bird.
I know being eaten alive seems like a nightmarish way to go, but the brood sac has a big picture approach. Each sac can contain up to 250 larvae, and a single snail can host multiple brood sacs, which is why you see snails with pulsating parasites in both eye stalks. And all of that is done just to look delicious to birds.
Parasitic disco worms need not just one, but two whole species in order to complete their life cycle. Because messing with one isn't horrific enough.
In the case of the green-banded brood sac, the snail is an intermediate host, the organism where the parasite lives and develops. The definitive host, in this case the bird, is where the parasite reaches sexual maturity.
Once inside, the green-banded brood sac larvae anchor to the wall of the bird's gut, where they mate with other adults, now called distomes, to increase the likelihood of mating success and producing a whole cloaca load of eggs. The adults are hermaphrodites, containing both male and female reproductive organs. How convenient.
About 2 weeks later, they start laying eggs, setting the trap for the next unsuspecting snail, and completing their life cycle.
But wait, hold on. Perching birds don't typically eat snails. How in the heck are the larvae going to get into the gut of a bird that doesn't even eat snails? Well, the green-banded broodsac has thought of everything.
This is where broodsac in their name comes in. This is the structure that turns the snails into a neon sign screaming, "I'm full of juicy caterpillars! Eat me!" The end of the larva that is shoved into the snail's eye stalks gets not just green bands, but an array of colors like white, red, black, and orange. The goal here is to be as garish as possible to catch the eye of passing birds. But being colorful isn't enough. Like a flashing advertisement on a tabloid's website, the green-banded brood sac wiggles and pulsates rhythmically, up to 80 times per minute, to further attract a bird's attention. All of this is in an effort to appear just like something a passerine would love to eat, like a moth or butterfly larva. This is a classic case of aggressive mimicry.
Aggressive mimicry is when a predator or a parasite imitates another species to manipulate the behavior of their prey or host.
There are many examples of this in nature. Females of the firefly genus Photurus, for example, will blink the patterns of other firefly species to draw in males and then eat them. Several anglerfish species wriggle a worm-like structure to make other fish believe it's a juicy snack to be had before snapping them up. Even the European cuckoo's eggs have evolved to look like those of other species, so the unwitting parents will raise the cuckoo hatchling as their own. In the case of the green-banded broodsac, the goal of this mimicry is to be enjoyed as a sumptuous songbird meal.
You would think that to combat all of this, the snail would just pull in its eye stalks, as it's capable of doing, and go hide under a rock till it was all over. Not so much.
The broodsac has completely taken up the snail's eye stalk real estate, and then some. The surface of the stalk has in fact become so stretched thin that it's completely see-through, allowing for this 5K display of color and motion. That's why, as I mentioned before, the translucent skin of the amber snail plays a key role in this grift. The snail can do nothing about all this, and is likely also already blind by this stage.
The snail's reproductive system is suppressed too, and all of its energy goes to supporting its technicolor parasite.
And to make matters worse, if the bird doesn't eat the whole snail but just takes out the brood sacs, the snail will regenerate the eye stalks, just to be quickly taken over by the brood sacs again.
The snail is truly powerless against this wriggling villain.
Okay, so now the snail's eye stalks are flashing bright colors, making them look just like a juicy caterpillar. But now comes the next problem for the brood sacs. Snails are nocturnal, moving around at night so they don't get fried by the sun. And passerines are out during the day.
What's the use of looking like a snack if no bird will ever see you?
Don't you worry, this nightmare parasite has a fix for that too. And yes, in case you were wondering how this creature could be even more like a horror movie monster, it starts mind controlling the snail.
If they didn't remind you of Ka from the Jungle Book before, with their rhythmically moving, color-changing eyes, they will now with their powers of hypnotization.
While we still don't understand exactly how it does it, the brood sac compels the snail to abandon its former nightlife and go out into the sun. The infected snail will crawl up higher than usual, into the bright light of the sun, and wait for a passing passerine.
Despite having no structure, that we know of anyway, that should help it see or even register the difference between night and day, the green-banded brood sacs only do their pulsating, look at me, dance during the day. So far, scientists haven't figured out how they do it. It's one of their great mysteries.
One thing we know for sure though, they really make these snails look otherworldly. But the green-banded broodsac is not the only flatworm parasite that has such a profound effect on its host. Euhaplorchis californiensis, for example, lives in the saltwater marshes of Southern California. It has a similar life cycle of bird poop to snail, but this time with the addition of killifish. Similar to broodsacs, Euhaplorchis has the ability to change the killifish's behavior to ensure it'll get eaten.
One study showed that infected killifish were 30 times more likely to be gobbled up by hungry water birds than their non-infected counterparts.
Ribeiroia ondatrae, otherwise known lovingly as frog-mutating flatworm, is thought to be one of the causes of a rash of strange frog limb malformations. While the cause isn't yet fully understood, researchers believe that the parasite interacts with the tadpole's developing hind limb buds, causing them to develop some seriously interesting constellations of legs, which makes it harder for the frog to move around and makes it easy for predators to catch it.
These parasitic flatworms certainly don't lack imagination. They take taking over to a whole new level of weird. Considering their proclivity for infecting their hosts in the weirdest ways, some of you may be wondering, are my eyeballs at risk?
Some good news. We know that the green-banded broodsac is incapable of infecting any other species, so we don't have to worry too much about our eyeballs being filled with writhing larvae. This is because parasites have evolved very specifically to take advantage of usually a single species in just the right way to get what they want.
Other mind-controlling parasites, like cordyceps, have been found in experiments to be able to infect and kill a range of ant species. But it's only able to mind-control the specific species it infects in nature.
When a bird comes by, plucking out the eyes of the snail, all the brood sac's hard work has finally paid off. And in an instant, the snail is released from this nightmare. Most snails eventually regenerate and are able to return to their normal snaily lives. Their reproduction, which the green-banded broodsac had switched off to ensure not a bit of energy was wasted during its time inside, even comes back online. The snail is safe, at least until they eat their next pile of infected bird poo.
This is just what the green-banded broodsac wants. Living hosts to help it continue its horror show life cycle again and again. Someone should conduct research on whether the amber snails ever learn from their eye-popping mistakes. I'm guessing nope on this one. So, what should we talk about next? Please let me know in the comments, and don't forget to subscribe for new episodes every week. Thank you for watching, and take care. Hang on a sec. I think I got something in my eye. Ugh, it's so itchy. Ugh. Oh God! Yeah. Ah!